Be at peace. Be at peace. Say Jesus. Got this lady up there, and she started shaking when he said she was a shaker. And she shook and shook and shook, and he talked, and when he was ready, finished with her and dismissed her from the platform, she actually hopped off the stage like a kangaroo.
The beast that's in all people.
Stop fighting. There's nothing you have to do. You know, there's nothing you have to do. Just, let me touch you.
I'm sorry.
I know you.
It's so hating him. You'd be so hateful.
Used to be hateful. You're sorry for being hateful now?
I didn't mean it.
I know you didn't.
The doctor said my wife couldn't have a child, but we know that she can because the Lord touched her tonight. And while I was standing back there, when you started to, just before you started calling out everything, I heard a rumble and a roar, and it sounded like a wind, and I thought, this sounds like second chapter of Acts. And I heard it, and it roared, and it rumbled, and I looked up, and it looked like the whole atmosphere filled with a mist, and it came
out
over.
I saw that mist. I saw it tonight.
And when it did, my sinuses opened up, and I almost fell over back there. I could hardly stand up, and I've been trembling ever since.
And your wife?
She said it felt like a rumbling came down inside of her, and a wind just sweeped through her at the same time. I just asked her. She heard it. She said no, but that's what it felt like.
You're going to have two children. Two. Here, that's the anointing of the Holy Ghost. The anointing of the Holy Ghost.
I saw once and for all how to break the curse of lack off of God's people and humanity. Once again, my phone number is 214-620-6-Basoto-Bakanda-Basaba-Baba-Baba-Saba-Bako-Ho-Masamanda-Bako-Soto. I'm trying to speak in English. Kabaso-Baba-Soto-Boko-Baba-Saka-Baka-Batondo-Mama-Katanda-Bakodo-Boso-Boko-Do-Baka-Da-Baka.
Maharishi's primary thrust is the marketing of his Siddhi Yoga, which is designed to develop psychic powers such as levitation. These courses, like most guru programs, cost thousands of dollars. Rob was able to finance his advanced training through government student loans, totaling $6,000.
During these sessions, it's a very strange environment. People speak in tongues, they yell and they scream, they talk in foreign languages. It's like a madhouse, and it's real crazy. Everyone bouncing around on foam pads, flying up in the air.
Rajneesh is one of India's most controversial gurus, largely because of his endorsement of shocking sexual practices, as a prerequisite for salvation.
I want to cause you to know that you are what Jesus was.
Jesus said that every human being was a god.
It is written that ye are gods. I'm a god and you're a god. And I'm a god and I'm going to stay a god until you recognize that you're a god. And when you recognize you're a god, I shall go back into principle and will not appear as a personality.
You are God.
But until I see all of you knowing who you are, I'm going to be very much what I am. God Almighty God.
Between himself and...
Never, never. You never can do that in a covenant relationship.
Do you know what else that has settled then tonight? This hue and cry and controversy that has been spawned by the devil to try and bring dissension within the body of Christ, that we're gods. I am a little god.
Yes. Yes.
I have his name. I'm one with him. I'm in covenant relationship. Yeah. I am a little god.
Critics, you are anything that he is.
Yeah.
God's reason for creating Adam was his desire to reproduce himself. I mean a reproduction of himself. And in the Garden of Eden, he did that. He was not a little like God. He was not almost like God. He was not subordinate to God even. And Adam is as much like God as you could get. Just the same as Jesus, when he came into the earth, he said, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father. He wasn't a lot like God. He's God manifested in the flesh. And I want you to know something. Adam in the Garden of Eden was God manifested in the flesh. God manifested in the flesh. God manifested in the flesh.
Kenneth Hagin has a teaching. A lot of people have problems with it, yet it is absolute truth. Kenneth Copeland has a teaching. Many Christians have put holes in it, but it's divine truth. Hagin and Copeland say, you are God. Ye are gods.
I can't be God.
Couldn't believe it. I mean, think about it, friends. What do you think people that are not saved and don't know the Lord, what's the first thing they think of when you mention to them something that has to do with Christianity? The very first thing, oftentimes as an evangelist, I hear, well, look at all the money grubbers on television. And we're here today to lay down the facts about what really goes on television, about the filthy lucre predicted, prophesied in the Bible. Dirty money. But if you think that what you've heard so far is really wild, you hang on to your seat because you're going to hear things that you think could not be possible coming from Christians that claim, my friends, to be born again. Like being a god. I mean, you think about it. That is Mormon theology. Mormons believe that when you die, if you've been a good Mormon, you will be Elohim. You will be an Elohim. You will be a god, and you will repopulate new worlds with your plurality of goddess wives. That's Mormon theology. That's Hindu teaching, that the gurus are themselves gods, as you are about to see in this video.
Stations of the Toronto Blessing has become known as Holy Laughter. Members of Pastor Arnott's ministry team pray with visitors to the vineyard, who then, for no apparent reason, burst into fits of uncontrollable laughter. The faithful firmly believe this laughter is caused by each person being filled with the Holy Spirit. But there are those who do not believe that what happens at the Toronto Vineyard is a direct sign of God's hand.
The first night I knew this, the first night that we were here,
it feels like something's happening to him. Something is happening to him, but it's being produced by his unconscious mind. It's not being produced by the Lord.
We asked an expert from the University of Toronto to view some of our tapes of the Vineyard meetings. Professor Edward Shorter has studied the history of religious hysteria.
I think there's an alternative explanation, and that is that we're dealing with an epidemic of hysteria here, an epidemic of religious hysteria, but this kind of thing is as old as the hills and goes back to the 17th century and before, people behaving in exactly this way.
Why would normal, sane people behave like this?
Well, they've been primed. They come with a script already in their minds. They know what they're supposed to do, although they don't know it at the level of the conscious mind. The script is in the unconscious mind, but it's nonetheless there. They know the kind of behavior they're supposed to reproduce. But this is characteristic of past epidemics of religious hysteria, just as it is characteristic today.
When you say, I'm a Christian, you're saying, I am Mashiach in the Hebrew. I'm a little Messiah walking on earth, in other words. I say it like this, you are a little God on earth on the ground.
Sai Baba is one of India's most powerful men, with millions of Indian disciples and a growing Western following. He says of himself, I am God. My power is divine and has no limit. There is no force, natural or supernatural, that can stop me or my mission. Today, hundreds of these professing godmen are invading the West.
There's just absolutely no getting out of that. What we're going to do in this video is we're going to examine the history behind the charismatic tongue-speaking movement and show from history with great men and what they have to say about the gift of tongues, healing, signs and wonders, holy laughter, all of that, the Vineyard movement. We're going to deal with those things today. Well, what is going on? I mean, could it be just learned behavior? Are people just showing off? Is it really the Spirit of God that moves people to be slain in the Spirit? My friend, I'm going to tell you, nobody in the Bible ever was slain in the Spirit. There were two people that fell on their backs in the Bible. Saul, on his way to kill King David, laid on his back for 3 days prophesying. And the Pharisees, when they came to get Jesus, they said, where is he? And Jesus said, here I am. And the Bible says they fell on their back. That is just not church practice. And even Benny Hinn will admit, it's not in the Bible. And I don't know why people do that, but that's what they do, and that's what he helps to promote. It's kind of like one preacher said, you're going to a rock concert. You look at the kids there and you think, how can those kids be doing a whole lot of that? It's because, my friends, they are under the pressure of the moment. They are under the enjoyment of letting loose and letting go. And I think that's what's happening in our churches today. And we're going to explore that for sure. I'd rather have the attitude that Daniel's friend, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego had when they were on their way into that fiery furnace. And what did the boys say? They said, God can deliver us. But if he doesn't, he is still the Almighty God.
During these sessions, it's a very strange environment. People speak in tongues, they yell and they scream, they talk in foreign languages. People speak in tongues, they yell and they fall.
Come out.
Be at peace. Be at peace.
He wasn't a lot like God. He's God manifested in the flesh. And I want you to know something. Adam in the Garden of Eden was God manifested in the flesh. Adam in the Garden of Eden was God manifested in the flesh.
Kenneth Hagin has a teaching. A lot of people have problems with it, yet it is absolute truth. Kenneth Copeland has a teaching. Many Christians have put holes in it, but it's divine truth. Hagin and Copeland say, you are God. Hagin and Copeland say, you are God. Hagin and Copeland say, you are God.
Well, my friends, I just came back from a trip from Toronto, and we had an opportunity to really talk to a young Mormon man and to make him understand that salvation is a gift. You don't earn it. You can't keep it by going to church. There's nothing you can do to get it other than what you can receive. See, it's not what you do for God that gets you into heaven. It's what God has done for us. He sacrificed his only begotten son. Now, I want to talk to you about that because it's important. Where do these men get the idea that we are going to be gods? Well, when I had preached to the Mormon guy and I had asked him, do you believe you're going to be a god? Elohim, the Hebrew word for God. In the beginning, Elohim. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Do you believe, I asked him, that you're going to be a god when you are in glory? And he said, yes, he did. And he, my friend, was one of very few. I have never met anybody in my life, my friends, that ever knew about John chapter 10. You see, I've talked to lots of Mormons, but you know that Mormons know you when they say to you, are you Luke? Well, that's what they did, and they do that to me. And I must admit, I speak to them an awful lot. They know me by name. They don't even know me personally, but they know it's me. And he quoted John chapter 10, where Jesus, when he was talking to the religious leaders of the day, said, is it not written that you are gods? And that's what I believe beyond a shadow of a doubt. Kenneth Copeland and Benny Hinn and all those men are quoting, thinking that Jesus is talking to us, and he is not. I wanted to talk to you about that. It is absolute foolishness to believe what Jim Jones said when he said, as you heard it, Jesus said that all humans are gods. That's not true. Jesus was talking to the religious rulers, the religious judges, the religious party of the day, the Sanhedrin, the Pharisees. And I don't know if you knew this. In the beginning, Elohim. Elohim, that Hebrew word, means a magistrate or a judge or a ruler, someone that is going to pass down justice, judgment, mercy, a judge. I mean, don't you know that the Bible says in 2 Corinthians 4:4, Satan is the god or the ruler or the judge of this world? The Bible makes that very clear. The Bible says in the book of Psalms, when Jesus was talking to the religious leaders of the day, he was quoting Psalms 82:1 and going down to verse 5. And then he quotes verse 6 by saying, I have said in the Psalms, you are gods, and all of you are the children of the Most High. But you will die like men and fall like one of the princes. Jesus was telling the religious leaders of his day that he was the Son of God. Well, if you're the Son of God, you're all God. Because if you're the Son of Man, you're all human, you're all man. Well, Jesus was saying he was the Almighty God. And the Pharisees wanted to kill him. Read it, John chapter 10. And the verse we're looking for in John chapter 10 is John chapter 10, verses 10 through 36, where Jesus, my friends, was saying that, what's the big deal if I say I'm the Son of God? Don't you know the scriptures say about you guys, the judges, the rulers? You are gods, you are rulers. What's the big deal, Jesus said when he said, what's the big deal if I say I'm the Son of God? And so Jesus says, why do you want to kill me? I'm doing good works here. And the Pharisees said, we're not killing you for good works. We're killing you because you, being a man, make yourself God. So what was Jesus really saying in John chapter 10? Jesus was saying about the religious rulers of the day that they were rulers, they were judges. Their job was to execute judgment and mercy and justice, and they weren't doing that because as rulers, as gods. Theos is the Greek word. They should have been doing their job. I don't know if you knew this, but all over the Old Testament, you will find the word Elohim in the beginning, God, translated, listen very carefully now, as the word judge in 1 Samuel 2:25. Again, as judges in Exodus 21:6, Exodus 22:18, Exodus 22:9. Jesus was the great I am, and he had appointed Elohims, or rulers that ruled over the people. That tradition was passed down until those rulers' grandchildren finally met the greatest ruler of all, the Almighty God. Because the Bible makes very clear, you are my witnesses, says the Lord. There were no gods before me. There will be no need of rulers after me. I am the only ruler. So Jesus wasn't saying to the Pharisees that everybody that's a believer is a god. That's nonsense. That is Mormon Hindu theology, my friend. Jesus was saying to the religious leaders of his day, you are theoses, gods. Now rule the people right. That's a beautiful thing. So Jesus, my friends, Jesus was saying, not everybody's a god, like Jim Jones taught, like Kenneth Copeland teaches, like a lot of TV preachers. Jesus was saying, there is the Almighty Ruler. Satan is the ruler, the god of this world. There were judges, or a judge, appointed by God through Moses. 70 men ruled or judged or took care of the people's problems. And that word judge in those verses is translated judge for the Hebrew word Elohim. Jesus was talking to the judges of God's people, and he was saying, look it, man, the Bible says you are judges. He's not saying that we are all gods.
Can you glorify God in your body when it doesn't function right? How can you glorify God? How can he get glory when your body doesn't even work? And the Bible says your body is the temple. He lives, the Holy Spirit lives in your body. What makes you think the Holy Ghost wants to live inside of a body where he can't see out through the windows and he can't hear with the ears? What makes you think the Holy Spirit wants to live inside of a physical body where the limbs and the organs and the cells do not function right? You don't want to live in a house with a leaky roof. You don't want to live in a house where the toilets are running over on the floor. You don't want to live in a run-down, broken-down house where the electricity doesn't work and the wires are hanging out of the wall. You get it fixed because you say this house can't function rightly unless everything is functioning as it was designed to function. How do you think then that God can get the glory out of your body when your body is the temple where God lives, and he wants, and what makes you think he wants to live in a temple where he can't see out of the eyes, and he can't walk with the feet, and he can't move with the hands? Because the only hands that he has in the earth realm are the hands that are in the body. The only eyes that he has that are in the earth realm are the eyes that are in the body. If he can't see out of them, then God's going to be limited. He's not going to be helped.
Suddenly, Dr. Cirillo's organization faced a major tragedy. It concerned Audrey Reynolds, a 25-year-old with a congenital brain abnormality who'd been an usher at the Earl's Court meetings. She'd gone up on stage to testify that her ankle had been cured.
How do you know that your leg is healed?
Because I can jump. I can jump.
You can.
And I can jump.
Let me see you jump.
On June the 27th, Audrey was found drowned in the bar. She had stopped taking her medication and had an epileptic fit. She'd been known to give up her medication on previous occasions, but nonetheless, the Southwark coroner declared, it is a tragedy that she went to this meeting and thought she was cured of everything. Sadly, it led to her death.
But the Toronto Vineyard also directed us to another, more dramatic healing. 2 years ago, doctors in the state of Washington told David Stark that he had lymphoma, a devastatingly painful and often terminal form of cancer.
And they said, this is very serious, you have it through your whole body, and quite honestly, we don't even know that there's much reason to attempt to treat you. Because usually if you have lymphoma and bone cancer this extensively, you don't respond to treatment.
What was the prognosis?
They thought that I would be dead in a couple months.
But David Stark survived for the next 2 years. He believes through the support of his Baptist church, where he works as an usher. Then last December, his health deteriorated still further.
The doctors were saying that I was definitely dying, and the Spirit of God was moving in our church in a mighty way, and the pastor and I were praying for people, and he turned and looked at me and he said, I think you're supposed to go to Toronto right away.
Years from now, you will read the history books of the Christian church. God did in Toronto.
David's Baptist pastor, Wendell Smith, had visited the Toronto Vineyard earlier in 1994 and brought back stories of strange and wonderful things.
What is happening in Toronto is a genuine, sincere, valid move of the Holy Spirit like many of us have never seen in our lifetime.
The pastor and his congregation in Seattle raised the funds to send the desperately ill David Stark to Toronto in the hope that he could be healed at the Vineyard.
Pastor John, in front of thousands of people, talks about the city church and the wonderful miracles that God has done. I think we ought to give the Lord a hand. Amen? Hallelujah.
In Toronto, David Stark asked one of Pastor Arnott's ministry team for help.
And he said, will you pray for me? I'm dying of cancer. The man was on 15 shots of morphine a day and still could not control his pain.
Revelation of your father's heart.
At the Vineyard gatherings, intensive prayer is used to call down the healing hand of God.
Open his heart.
As this man put his hands up to pray for me, I just tipped backwards. And as I fell backwards, I wanted to know what time it happened. And I looked at my watch, and it was exactly 3:40. I saw the second hand click down.
It's such a strange thing to look at your watches.
But I like to know when God does things in my life.
Within hours of his pain disappearing, David's remarkable transformation was recorded by the Vineyard's own cameras.
16 morphine applications a day in order to stand the pain and be able to move around. I couldn't get my shoes on or get dressed.
Praise the Lord.
I sure can now.
Amen.
I have no pain.
Hallelujah.
No pain. No pain.
Thank you, Lord.
No pain.
Thank you, Jesus.
And the cancer was gone, and I started to laugh. And when I shared it with the people around me, they started to laugh. And pretty soon there's 30, 40, 50 people on the floor in hysterics.
What happened was he fell to the floor laughing. And he laughed, I don't know, for how long, Ian? 15 minutes. And he got up and went and sat down. But then he handed Ian a note later on. He said, I've been completely healed. My pain is gone.
At the celebration for the Toronto Vineyard's first anniversary, a letter from David Stark's doctor was quoted by Pastor Arnott as proof that a miracle had happened.
Just, I think, 3 or 4 days ago now, we get a fax from David, which is a copy of his doctor's letter to him. I feel like your clinical response following the prayer meeting in Toronto is nothing short of miraculous.
But his doctor in Seattle, Kyle Bryan, told us that David Stark has not been cured.
What he had was a tremendous response in his pain. I think it's important for everyone to realize the difference between a cure and a response. And so I must say that I'm a bit uncomfortable with them using it as some type of endorsement or as evidence of a miracle cure, because I don't have evidence that it's a miracle cure.
6 weeks after returning from Toronto, David and his wife Lisa received bad news about his lymphoma cancer from Dr. Bryan.
Recently, David was experiencing an increase in the pain in his back. The repeat scan shows that there's been a significant, in some views, about a 50% increase in the amount of lymphoma that's present. There's been definite progression of the disease.
The doctor has the hard medical evidence that your tumor has grown by 50%, that your cancer is getting worse. But your belief is that you've been cured. Why don't you believe your doctor?
Well, the doctor said that I probably wouldn't make it back from Toronto, but I came back enormously changed. I've never, ever experienced the kind of pain that I was in when I went to Toronto.
It's not the first time I've seen a patient who had an extraordinary amount of pain who then obtained relief of their pain from methods that would not be considered conventional. For some people, it's their faith and they turn to God.
And may David Stark be the first of thousands and hundreds of thousands that will be healed by the power of the Holy Spirit for the glory of God. Let it come, Lord. Let it come.
What we might have said in the past might have been too premature. I don't know. But
but he is in your magazine as a physical healing.
Yeah, based on the information that he supplied and his pastor supplied, we ran a little news update there that there was a wonderful healing in this man's life, seemingly totally cured. In actual fact, I don't think he is totally cured at this point.
Well, he's not.
But I would certainly join my faith with his and say, push it all the way. And we'll be praying for him and continue.
God came from heaven, became a man, made man into little gods, went back to heaven as a man. He faces the Father as a man. I face devils as the Son of God. You see what I'm talking about? You say, Benny Hinn, am I a little God? You're a son of God, aren't you? You're a child of God, aren't you? You're a daughter of God, aren't you? What else are you? Quit your nonsense. What else are you?
I am.
If you say I am, you're saying I'm a part of him, right? Is he God?
Yes.
Are you his offspring?
Yes.
Are you his children?
Yes.
You can't be human. I feel revelation knowledge already coming on me here. I want you to just lift your hand. Something new is going to happen here today. I felt it just as I walked down here. Holy Spirit, take over in the name of Jesus. Say amen.
Amen.
Ladies and gentlemen, are you here to learn?
Amen.
And you sit there and don't think about your chicken and about your roast and about your spaghetti. Anything else, put it all out of the way right now. This is life to us. God the Father, ladies and gentlemen, is a person, and he is a triune being by himself, separate from the Son and the Holy Ghost. So what did you say?
Hear it.
See, God the Father is a person. God the Son is a person. God the Holy Ghost is a person. But each one of them is a triune being by himself. If I can shock you, and maybe I should, there's 9 of them. What did you say? Let me explain. God the Father, ladies and gentlemen, is a person with his own personal spirit, with his own personal soul, and his own personal spirit body. You say, oh, I never heard that. Well, you think you're in this church to hear things you heard for the last 50 years? One of the strangest experiences I had a few years ago visiting Amy's tomb in California. Friday, I'm going to go and visit Catherine Kuhlman's tomb. It's close by Amy's in Forest Lawn Cemetery. I've been there once already. I felt a terrific anointing when I was there. I trembled when I visited Amy's tomb. I was shaking all over. God's power came all over me. I believe the anointing has lingered over Amy's body. Someone asked me, how is it you can feel the anointing around a tomb? I said, I have no idea, man, but I sure felt it. You're going to feel the anointing at Amy's tomb. It's incredible. And Catherine, it's amazing. I've heard of people healed when they visited that tomb. They were totally healed by God's power. See, what a crazy thing. Brother, there's things we'll never understand.
And I love Copeland. He's my friend. And anybody who's attacking him is attacking the very presence of God.
You don't have a God in you. You are one.
If we're still questioning what was said about that prophecy never mentioned the Son of God. Never said anything about the Son of God.
What did it say?
It said, I did not claim to be God. Mm-hmm. And that's all it said.
In other words, in so many words, you're right. Nowhere in the New Testament did he literally get
preach up. Preach and claim
and
that he was
say,
God.
And say, I am God, did he? Now, yeah. I stand corrected.
And the Christian attitude.
I was shocked when I found out who the biggest failure in the Bible actually is.
Okay.
You know, everybody you ask, you say, who's the biggest failure? They say, Judas. Somebody else will say, no, I believe it's Adam.
Well, how about the devil? He's the most consistent failure.
Okay.
But he's not the biggest in terms of material failure and so forth. The biggest one in the whole Bible is God. Mm. Oh, what? Don't you turn that set off. You listen to what... I told you now, you sit still a minute. You know me well enough, no, I wouldn't tell something that I can't prove with the Bible.
Heaven has a north and a south and an east and a west. Consequently, it must be a planet. The Bible said he measured the heavens with a 9-inch span. Now, the span is the difference, distance between the end of the thumb and the end of the little finger. And that Bible said, in fact, the Amplified Translation translates the Hebrew text that way, that he measured out the heavens with a 9-inch span. Well, I got a ruler and measured mine, and my span's 8 3/4 inches long. So now God's span is a quarter inch longer than mine. So you see, that faith didn't come billowing out of some giant monster somewhere. It came out of the heart of a being that is very uncanny the way he's very much like you and me. A being that stands somewhere around 6'2", 6'3", that weighs somewhere in the neighborhood of a couple of 100 pounds, a little better, has a span of 9 inches across, stood up and said, "Light be!" And this universe situated itself and went into motion. This is all a copy. It's a copy of home. It's a copy of the mother planet. Where God lives, he made a little one just like his and put us on it.
You know that God created Adam, and we won't go back over all that again. He created him in authority. He said, God said, and it was. God said, let there be light, and it was. And then he came up to create man and said, God said, let us create man in our image. Let him have dominion. Those were the words that he used to bring Adam alive. And then he created Eve out of Adam. Now, actually, God didn't name her Eve. Adam named her Eve later. That wasn't her name. Her name was Adam. Adam, when God said Adam, they both came. Their authority was one and the same together. They did everything together. They had always been together. Even when she was still part of him, he was as much female as he was male, like God is, and God separated the female part of him and then put them back together, and she was Adam. They were Adam. He was the man, she was the woman, she was the man with the womb.
He lost his top-ranking, most anointed angel, the first man he ever created, first woman he ever created, the whole earth and all the fullness therein, a third of the angels at least. That's a big loss, man. I mean, you figure all that, that's a lot of real estate, brother, gone down the drain. Now, the reason you don't think of God as a failure is he ain't never said he's a failure. No. And you're not a failure till you say you won.
You know, we people say things at times that we are not even supposed to say. Look at me, everybody. You know what? We've said this a million times, and it's not even scriptural, all because of Job. The Lord giveth, and the Lord taketh away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. I have news for you. That is not Bible. That's not Bible. The Lord giveth and never taketh away. And just because he said, blessed be the name of the Lord, don't mean that he's right. When he said, blessed be the name, he was just being religious. When you say something that disagrees with the word of God, you are literally being controlled by hell. When you say something that disagrees with the word of God, you are literally being controlled by hell.
Oh.
We've even used the statement that Job made, which was an incorrect statement. And if you learn, I can't go into that now because it's too involved. But Job said, the Lord has given and the Lord has taken away. How many times have you heard the preacher say that at a funeral? Huh? Well, the Lord has given and the Lord has taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. How are you going to bless God and he just took your wife? Now, that's the dumbest thing in the world. Huh?
When you call Jesus really, you have called me. When you call me really, you have called Jesus.
It's an unfortunate thing what you're actually seeing today happening in the signs and wonders movement. But I remember something that I had watched on television. A journalist sought to go into the Appalachian Mountains because there's another scripture in the book of Mark that says, these signs shall follow them that believe. They'll pick up deadly serpents, drink poison, not die, speak in tongues. So it's very common for Christians today to say, do you speak in tongues? Well, no, I don't. Well, these signs shall follow them that believe. If you're not speaking in tongues, then you're not saved. And that is not true, because the Bible tells us in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, the last verse there, are all apostles? No. Are all prophets? No. Do all have the gift of healings? No. And just a bunch of questions. He says, do all speak in tongues? No. So what is meant in Mark chapter 16, verses 9 through 19? Well, what's meant there is these signs did follow them that believe, the apostolic age. And you can prove that very easily by reading the book of Acts. It's not saying these signs shall follow all them that believe. These signs shall follow them that believe. And it did in the book of Acts. Because, my friends, these signs shall follow them that believe. They'll speak in tongues. My friends, do all have the gift of tongues? 1 Corinthians chapter 12, the last verse there? No, the gift of tongues is not for everybody. And it did follow the apostolic age. So the journalist went to the Appalachian Mountains to see the snake handlers. And my friends, he was converted to Christ. He became a Christian. Because yes, he believed in Jesus, but he didn't realize the Bible taught that they'll pick up deadly serpents. Well, my friends, didn't Paul do that in the book of Acts? That's not saying that we should put God to the test, that we should show our faith by picking up deadly serpents. My friends, you could die. Watch this.
In a converted gas station, Covington found the Summerfords Church. It looked typical of many in Appalachia, at least at first glance.
I don't believe you have to have a snake to go to heaven, but I believe you're going to have to believe it.
But it became clear just how strangely different this church was when portions of this tape were played in court during the Summerford trial. There's Glenn Summerford and his wife, Darlene. They were serpent handlers, Christian fundamentalists in a most extreme sense, who take the Bible literally, especially one verse from the book of Mark, chapter 16, which says, believers shall take up serpents, poisonous snakes. So Covington began researching snake handling and found it can be dangerous, if not deadly.
If God don't want me to die, man, he will not let me die.
In the late 1960s, filmmakers were present when this preacher was bitten on the hand.
That's God's word, good folks. If I die with this snake bite, it's still God's word.
This preacher survived. In the 1980s, Charles Prince, one of the most flamboyant snake handlers, was bitten on the left hand. He, like other snake handlers before him, refused medical help, believing the bite was God's will, and only prayer could save him. His arms swelled to grotesque proportion. After 36 agonizing hours, he died.
The Holy Spirit said something to me, and I had to go like a madman looking in the Word. He says, God's original plan is that the woman was to bring forth children out of her side. What? You know that there's nowhere in the Bible but where God gives birth out of his side? Jesus gave birth to the church out of his side. Adam gave birth to his wife out of his side. It was sin that turned the thing around.
Now, my precious brother, I know this is a tape also. Now, don't get excited. Let me say this with godly love. The hour's approach where I can't hold still on these things no more. too close to coming, see? Trinitarianism is of the devil. I say that, thus saith the Lord.
God uses normal individuals. Whether it's Smith Wigglesworth or Catherine Kuhlman or Amy or A.A. Allen or William Branham, great men of God.
Yeshua we do not see as being God when he walked here on earth. We see him as a man.
A man anointed by God.
A man anointed by God, sent by God to perform a function. Now, in his resurrection,
he's not God.
We do not see him as God. We see him as a man anointed by God and that has been restored. There is nothing in the statements of Yeshua, in the statements of the disciples, that would cause one to believe that they were proclaiming that he was deity.
Quit this old cop-out prayer, if it be thy will, bunk.
If you have to say that, if it be thy will or thy will be done, if you have to say that, then you're calling God a fool.
I'm going to pray the prayer of faith, not one of those, Lord, if it be thy will. I don't have to pray a prayer of doubt and unbelief.
Because we didn't understand what Jesus said, and because we've been religiously brainwashed and stood New Testament taught, we watered down the promises of God and tacked on something that Jesus didn't say and added on something else to it. Well, he will, all right, if it's his will, but it might not be his will, people have said. And yet, you don't find that kind of talk in the New Testament.
We attended this crusade in Las Vegas. By our count, there were 56 miracles in all, many of which ended up on Hinn's TV show and on this videotape we purchased through the ministry. There was this woman. Hinn said God told him a demon had given her cancer, and he cast it out.
Go out of her! It's gone!
And there was this woman who said she was cured of lung cancer.
She had cancer in the lung.
Oh, she don't have it now.
And then there was this little boy named William, who became the star of this crusade when he told Pastor Benny his damaged vision had been healed.
And as soon as God healed me, I could see better.
Hinn seemed to be especially moved by the youngster.
Our ministry should do all possible to help this boy financially, to even pay for his education.
The question is, despite all those claims, how does anyone really know if William or any of the others truly was miraculously healed? The ministry has said it has a process to verify miracle healings that is, quote, exhaustive and thorough. So we asked Pastor Benny to give us the material verifying the 56 healings we counted at that crusade in Las Vegas. By the time we asked, he'd already broadcast many of those Vegas miracles around the world on television.
I want you to go back to your earthly doctor. I want a full story.
But if Hinn knows the full story about who was healed in Las Vegas, he didn't share it with us. In a letter from its lawyer, the ministry declined to provide proof of any of those Las Vegas healings to Dateline. So then we did some more checking of our own. For example, that woman we met in Las Vegas who said she'd been cured of lung cancer. With our hidden camera, we were able to go backstage to observe the ministry's follow-up interview with her.
Now, what happened tonight that makes you feel God touched you?
She was asked a few questions, but it didn't appear to us that there was any medical examination.
Keep trusting God. Follow it up with your physicians.
Thank you so much.
Let me just
the Lord bless you all.
Unfortunately, there is one thing we were able to determine about this woman without the ministry's help. 2.5 months after the crusade, she died. The cause was lung cancer. Also introduced you to Belva Ventura. Benny Hinn said her cancer was cast out at a crusade in Massachusetts.
Yeah, I was healed. I know I was.
According to her doctor, Belva Ventura died of that cancer shortly after our interview. But whether those miracles are verified or not, the money pours in at Benny Hinn's Crusades. While the crusade continues on stage, backstage, the money is totaled up. The take often in the hundreds of thousands of dollars.
One side cash, one side check.
Though Hinn refuses to make his financial information public, he has said that every dollar given to his ministry goes to the work of the Lord. Followers like Carletta Moore in Delaware told us they have no doubt that's true.
We're not giving it to Pastor Benedict. We're giving it to the ministry to do the work that Pastor Benedict has been entrusted to do.
That as it may, Benny Hinn does manage to live very well. His home is this mansion overlooking the Pacific Ocean, built and paid for by his ministry. According to building records, it has 7 bedrooms, 8 bathrooms, and more than 7,000 square feet of living space. The ministry told us the mansion was its parsonage and a good investment. According to area realtors, today it's worth about $10 million. And when Hinn goes to crusades around the world, he travels in this private jet. According to documents we obtained, the ministry pays more than $112,000 a month to use the plane. And closer to home, Pastor Benny still travels in style. This photo obtained by Dateline shows him getting out of a Mercedes SUV. And here he is driving a Mercedes convertible. Both cars retail for about $80,000. Michael Horton is an evangelical Christian and a professor of theology at Westminster Seminary in California. He edited a book called The Agony of Deceit, which took a critical look at televangelists, including Benny Hinn.
A lot of people, I think, who watch Benny Hinn or watch the TV evangelists more generally, think that what they're saying is authoritative. After all, they're on TV, and they've written books. And we've lost a capacity to think critically and to weigh people in the light of what the scriptures teach.
And at every crusade and on every broadcast, Benny Hinn's followers hear stories of miracles from their pastor's lips.
You better get a handkerchief today. You're going to see what God did in Las Vegas, especially to a little boy named William.
Remember William, the boy who said his deteriorating vision had been healed at that crusade in Las Vegas?
And now your eyes, you can see better?
Mm-hmm.
That night, Pastor Benny went beyond just declaring William cured.
Our ministry should do all possible to help this boy financially, to even pay for his education.
But almost 3 years after Pastor Benny's promises, William's family says their boy hasn't received a dime from Benny Hinn.
We don't need his money. You know, I can take care of William.
Randy Melthratter is William's uncle and guardian.
He made a promise to the world and to my little boy, and I just think it's right that he does what he said he was going to do.
According to Randy Melthratter, after a year of calling the ministry, he was finally told a fund of $10,000 had been established. But he says he never received any verification of that, and that the ministry refuses to give him any more information. And Melthratter also told us he's upset that the Hinn ministry has been raising money using William's name. In an email to us, the ministry maintained there is a $10,000 account and that William's family can have access to it. Further, the ministry claims William's family had demanded $1 million, which his uncle vehemently denies. As for his boy's eye condition, Randy Melthratter says at first William believed he had been healed. But a couple of weeks later, he asked William if his vision was really any better.
He thought about it for a second. He goes, I think God's just taking a break. And that, to me, was like, you know, that's a heck of a thing for a little boy to have to make excuses for why God hasn't healed him.
Chapter 1. My cat eats kitty fritters.
William is now 13 years old. Randy told us he has a degenerative and incurable eye condition called retinaschisis. But William can see better these days. What's made the difference? Not anything that happened at that crusade, but...
glasses. I'm glad they could find
because my old doctor said they couldn't find a prescription for me.
Thanks to those special glasses, William doesn't have to use Braille anymore and leads a fairly active life. In the meantime, Pastor Benny has millions of followers who donate millions of dollars to his ministry, not only to help him preach the gospel, but also, as he says, to feed and clothe thousands of children around the world. But that's not what that former HIN employee says he found.
To me, this was a fraud and deception being put across the people that are his donors.
How many children does the ministry support? Dateline follows up as some Christian critics weigh in on Pastor Benny's lifestyle.
You're called to be a servant, a bondservant of Christ, not to live like a king.
And look at these eyes. I have never lied to you. Never. I never will. I'd rather die than lie to God's people.
Suddenly, I began to be aware that my body, that my spirit is coming out of my body. And it scared me, and I grabbed hold of it with my will, and wouldn't let it go. You said the day you were down there in such and such town, standing over there behind that curtain, and your spirit started coming out of your body, and you jerked back like that and thought you was dying, and you let fear get hold of you, and I remember I did. I said, well, God, I mean, really, now, is this what kind of a hoss do you think I am? That they're not going to, you know, at least give you a few chills to stand there and die. He said, you weren't dying. I said, what do you mean I wasn't dying? My spirit was coming out of my body. He said, that's right. You were fixing. He said, you were just about to come out of your body, and I was going to allow you to minister to that congregation without your body. You were going to go through that congregation like a whirlwind of the power and the glory of God. I said, you let's show me that in the scripture. He said, and he showed me 2 Corinthians chapter 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. He said, you missed that opportunity for that experience. I said, what was I going to do? He said, I'm not going to tell you. You missed it.
Heretic hunters, these guys who spend their lives straightening us all out doctrinally, they're going to go straight to hell. They're going to absolutely...
Several people that I know have criticized... Some of them are dead right today in an early grave because of it, and there's more than one of them got cancer.
Let me say something else too, and I really don't care if you like this or not. You have attacked me, your children will pay for it.
I think they're damned and on their way to hell, and I don't think there's any redemption for them. I say to hell with you!
You attacking on the radio every night. You tell, and your children will. Hear this from the lips of God's servant. You are in danger.
I say, get out of God's way. Quit blocking God's bridges, for God's going to shoot you if I don't.
And I love Copeland. He's my friend. And anybody who is attacking him is attacking the very presence of God.
I refuse to argue any longer with any of you out there. Don't even call me if you want to argue doctrine, if you want to straighten somebody out over here, if you want to criticize Ken Copeland for his preaching on faith or Dad Hagen, get out of my life. I don't want to even talk to you or hear you. I don't want to see your ugly face.
There's a group here in California that thinks they're the judgment seat of Christ. Dear God in heaven, I wish I can just... They call it a ministry in my foot. Yeah. You know, I've looked for one verse in the Bible. I just can't seem to find it. One verse that said, if you don't like him, kill him. I really wish I could find it. You stink, frankly. That's the way I think about it. I'm sorry. I'm not exactly the normal kind of guy, you know. I'm from Israel. Sometimes I wish God would give me a Holy Ghost machine gun. I'll blow your head off.
You may want to give a little more because, ladies and gentlemen, wonderful partners that you've stood with me all these years, I'm a little behind on my TV stations.
After our first story aired, Pastor Benny sent his followers this fundraising letter. He said there had been a 10% drop in donations because of the Dateline story. He began a major fundraising campaign, explaining he needed more money to pay for TV time.
But in fact, the need is $2 million I must have right away.
This ministry is touching the nations with...
On Hinn's broadcast after our first story, a ministry staffer maintained that some of that money is spent, not just for TV time, but for good works around the world, every day.
20,000 children are fed and clothed and taken care of on a daily basis by Benny Hinn Ministries.
But remember Nathan Daniel, the TV producer hired by the ministry? He told us that in 2002, when he asked for verification of the thousands of children cared for by the ministry, he was given this email from a ministry staffer. It listed just 247 orphans. Daniel said that left him wondering how many children the ministry actually supports.
And that troubled me deeply. To me, this was a fraud and deception being put across the people that are his donors.
He says shortly after raising questions about the ministry's good works and its healings, he was fired and escorted from his ministry office by armed guards.
Amen.
For its part, the ministry sent us this video of the ribbon-cutting ceremony for its new orphanage building in Mexico. And after the tsunami disaster, Hinn announced that during his three-day crusade in India, he would deliver a check for $250,000 to aid victims of the tragedy. Dateline has also confirmed that the Hinn Ministry donates $20,000 a month to this hospital in Calcutta. In addition, a hospital spokesperson said over the years, Hinn has given two lump sum donations totaling $200,000.
Pre-medical care completely is covered by the Benny Hinn Ministries.
That may sound like a lot of money, and in India it certainly is. But the donations for tsunami aid and the money given to the hospital are only a tiny fraction of the tens of millions of dollars the ministry takes in each year. Pastor Benny's lavish lifestyle, supported by ministry money.
Every dollar you give this morning is going to the work of the Lord.
What we got were ministry expense documents for 2003 that are a kind of snapshot of how Pastor Benny spends his life and the ministry's money when he travels. But even with these documents, it's not easy to follow the money. Many of Benny Hinn's expenses were signed for by his director of security using a ministry corporate credit card. But we didn't take the documents at face value. We set out to independently verify the information they contain to confirm where Hinn stays and how he spends money.
We have all heard from the Lord that the days ahead are dark days.
According to the expense forms and multiple ministry sources, when he travels, Pastor Benny registers at hotels under an assumed name. A look at these documents shows that while he's on ministry business, Hinn stays in luxury hotel rooms.
God will anoint his ministers tonight.
At this crusade in Milwaukee, the documents indicate Benny Hinn occupied the presidential suite of the Pfister Hotel. The hotel told us the room cost $990 a night. At a crusade in Panama, the documents show, and we verified with the Intercontinental Hotel, that Hinn was in the Royal Suite, the published rate, $1,700 a night. At a crusade in Montreal, we verified Pastor Benny was ensconced in the Royal Suite of the St. James Hotel. The regular rate there, $2,700 a night. The room is as big as an average house, 2,200 square feet, including a makeup room, dressing room, and a piano that plays by itself.
And partners, thank you for helping us go around the world.
The ministry told us some hotels allow Pastor Hinn to stay free of charge or at a discounted rate because the ministry or his followers are paying for a block of other rooms. And as Hinn's supporter Carletta Moore, a minister herself, told us in our first report, she has no problem with the style in which Pastor Benny travels.
I'm pretty sure NBC's man that owns NBC probably got his own jet and multi-million dollar, probably got houses here, houses there. And I believe that the preachers of the gospel, I believe they should live better than even NBC's president.
Not surprisingly, Hinn critic Ole Anthony has a different view.
It's just a lifestyle. He believes he deserves it. His board of directors says it's okay. So what are you going to do?
Well, I can't deny the fact that when I'm talking about giving and offerings and the principle of tithing in the church, I always struggle with that. And a lot of it is because the world already has that money-grubbing attitude towards Christianity. Well, I want to try to encourage you here today by telling you, if you really are looking at Christianity as a religion that you might want to choose, you need to keep your eyes on the Savior, Christ, who makes Christians, who are part of Christianity, and believe me, he will not let you down. Jesus says, all they that come unto me, I will in no wise cast out. You can come to Christ, receive him as your Savior, so that you too can be what Jesus wants you to be for him. Not coming to Jesus so that he can do for you what you want him to do for you, which is the problem within the signs and wonders movement. They come to the master for what the master has at his table instead of coming to the master for what the master is as a person. God is a wonderful person, and he has a plan for your life, and it might not line up with what you like or what you want, but in the end, glory will be brought to the Lord Jesus Christ, and you will have an abundant life. There's just no getting out of it. What is the prosperity gospel? Because it's all about the money. The prosperity gospel, according to modern TV evangelists, is there's no reason for you to be poor. There's no reason for you to be sick. If you're poor or you're sick, you don't have enough faith. So they tell you, come to God by faith. Give 100-fold, because if you give $10, God will give you 100-fold. He'll give you back $1,000. It's called the prosperity gospel, as you're about to hear. It essentially tells people that if you come to Christ, He's going to make sure that you're rich, that you're well cared for, that everything you have will be nothing but good. But my friends, not all the Christians are going to die of old age. Some of us are going to die naturally under the curse, and unfortunately, many of us by cancer. Let's face it. Fred Price is wrong when he says God won't use a body that's sick, that limbs that won't work, eyes that don't see. That's a sin. And a good example of that is in the Gospel of John, where they ask Jesus, who sinned, this blind man or his parents? And Jesus said, neither have sinned. This has happened so that God can be glorified. And remember, Jesus healed him. But not everybody's going to get a healing. There's nothing wrong with asking. And it's wrong to say praying and God's will in your life is a sin. The Bible makes it very clear we are to pray God's will in our life. Christianity, my friend, is not all about money. It's about our Savior and serving Him the way He wants us to serve Him. It's not about the streets of gold here and now. Watch this.
Here, my friend, is a conglomeration of men like Frederick Price, Benny Hinn, Kenneth Copeland, Robert Tilton, Kenneth Hagin, all speaking out on why they want the streets of gold here and now.
I'm sick and tired of hearing about streets of gold. I don't need gold in heaven. I gotta have it now. I mean, when I get to glory, all my bills will be paid, brother. I won't have bills in glory. I won't need to worry about bills in glory. I can have it here. You say, well, Benny Hinn, isn't that wonderful to have gold streets in glory? Well, of course. But if I hear the thing one more time of how it will be and how it was, I'm going to kick somebody.
Get you out of this malaise of thinking that Jesus and the disciples were poor and then relating that to you, thinking that you as a child of God have to follow Jesus. The Bible says that He has left us an example that we should follow His steps. That's the reason why I drive a Rolls Royce. I'm following Jesus' steps.
I don't know where these goofy traditions creep in at, but one of the goofiest ones is that Jesus and His disciples were poor. Now, there's no Bible to substantiate that.
You can talk about me all you want while I'm driving by in my Rolls Royce that's paid for and I got the pink slip on it. Talk all you want. Bad mouth all you want. Don't hurt me in the least. Don't bother me. It's a whole lot easier to be persecuted when I'm riding in my car and I got the pink slip than it is when I'm riding in the car and owe my soul to the company store.
A prophet began to pukwabashata, prophesy. Make me a cake. She's got to do something. I'm telling you, you got to do something. I like $1,000 vow, because I like, don't like half-hearted people, lukewarm, just, well, I'll do a little. I like $1,000 vow of faith.
That spirit of poverty is broken when you get to that phone and say, put me down as one that's going to give $5,000.
Tonight, I want to speak that 100-fold increase. If you will call right now, and you will say to your counselor whenever they answer the phone, I want to be involved in the 100-fold. I want the 100-fold prayer prayed over my giving tonight. I will, at the time that God leads me to do it, I will lay hands on every one of those cards and will speak the 100-fold increase into your life. Remember, the word to say is the 100-fold.
My people perish for a lack of knowledge. What knowledge? The knowledge of their covenant with me, saith the Lord. Are you listening to me? Are you listening to the Spirit of God tonight? You don't have to be poor. Jesus said, I am anointed to preach the gospel. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me to preach the gospel to the poor. Hey, poor, you don't have to be poor anymore.
You don't think these apostles didn't walk around with money? I mean, they had money. I'm just thank God that I saw this and gave up the denominational line and got on God's land before I starved me and all my family to death. Paul had the kind of money that people, that government officials would block up justice to try to get a bribe out of old Paul. Jesus had a nice house, a big house. John 19 tells us that Jesus wore designer clothes. Well, what else are you going to call it? Now, designer clothes, that's blasphemy. No, that's what we call them today. I mean, you didn't get the stuff he wore off the rack. It wasn't a one-size-fits-all deal. No. No, this was custom stuff.
The Bible says that he had a treasurer, a treasury. They called it the bag, that they had one man who was the treasurer named Judas Iscariot, and the rascal was stealing out of the bag for three and a half years, and nobody knew that he was stealing. You know why? Because there was so much in it, he couldn't tell. Nobody could tell that anything was missing. If he had three oranges in the bottom of the bag and he stole two of them, don't tell me, you wouldn't know that something was missing.
That's the Bible. That's the word of God. There is prosperity. Not only is worrying a sin, but being poor is a sin when God promises prosperity.
To have holes in the bird's air, the nest have their, the bird's air have a nest. The Son of Man hath nowhere to lay his head is not a declaration that Jesus didn't have a house. It's simply, if you'll read a few verses above that, it meant that the Samaritans canceled the meeting that he was going to, if you remember the account. And in those days, there wasn't a Holiday Inn on every corner. You didn't just, you know, check into the hotel. If your advance men got canceled, then you walked to the next meeting and had to take up there. And it's very clear that he had a house. The Bible states he had a house.
And look at these eyes. I have never lied to you. Never.
That is glory. That is glory.
Whether he's at home or traveling, Benny Hinn can often be seen in the finest places. Hinn is a regular at Beverly Hills clothing stores like Versace, Louis Vuitton, and Bijan, where Hinn's name is on the window along with princes and heads of state. Then there are the cars and the mansion. Hinn has acknowledged he's paid a salary of somewhere between $500,000 and $1 million a year. He also gets royalties from the sales of his books. But there are questions raised by some of the purchases we found in those expense documents. For example, in just over 4 weeks in 2003, we found six separate charges at high-end clothing stores totaling more than $6,000, all charged on the ministry's corporate card. Remember, while he's at a crusade, Pastor Benny stays in presidential and royal suites. The ministry told us that every single trip made by Pastor Benny is approved by his executive board. But we were intrigued by what appear to be stops made by Pastor Benny at resorts and spas around the world on his way to and from crusades. The ministry called these stops layovers. Now, for most of us travelers, a layover means long hours waiting for a connection in an unfamiliar airport, maybe an overnight stay at a low-rent hotel. But remember, Pastor Benny travels in the ministry's private jet and sets his own schedule. So consider Benny Hinn's version of a layover.
Porque no podía escuchar de ese oído izquierdo.
On his way home to California from this crusade in Colombia, the documents show, and the hotel confirmed for us, Pastor Benny stopped at this resort in Cancun, Mexico. He stayed in the presidential suite there that cost the ministry $2,684 for one night. The trip was described as a layover. And here's another example of what may happen to some of the money people give to Benny Hinn for God's work. After crusades in Russia and Sweden in July of 2003, Pastor Benny apparently didn't get on his private jet, fly west, and go home. Instead, he flew from Sweden south to Italy, then back north to England, with an entourage that included his son, his daughter, and her fiancé. There were expensive meals, like this one for more than $900 in Italy, and one at this Lebanese restaurant in London for more than $1,700.
Now, friends, we're going to deal with the end of these quotes one at a time, and it's to our sorrow that the evangelist, faith healer, Frederick Price's wife has now contracted ovarian cancer.
2 days after I had was scheduled for this major surgery in order for them to find out what was wrong. Well, then that's when they found out that I had the cancer. Was a lymphoma in my pelvic area.
Our dearly beloved, beautiful Christians like this woman do not need the advice of Hobart Freeman, another TV evangelist.
To say that if we have a drug available or a medical treatment available, we ought to resort to that just won't line up with the Word of God. You just can't make that line up with the Word of God.
Or even the advice of Benny Hinn and Paul Crouch.
The word salvation is sozo, which means deliverance from sin and sickness.
I see it, Benny.
Even though there may be a manifestation in my flesh that a doctor would call a normal physical illness, what you're telling me is there is an architect behind that sickness or that illness, which is an evil spirit.
Exactly right.
And ultimately the father of the whole thing is the devil himself, right?
Exactly right.
Now, in the mind of Copeland, if you do die, it's because you had little of faith. Of which he has great faith, but he can only be used so far.
I've had people die, and me standing there saying, bless God, you ain't gonna die. And they did anyway. And I'm glad I stood.
Yes.
I'm glad I stood.
Amen.
I'm glad I stood. But I ain't never stood for anything in my own life that didn't come to pass. I can only use my faith just so far with you.
Now, friends, it was Jesus who said, by thy words thou shalt be justified, and by thy words thou shalt be condemned or judged. Remember Frederick Price? It's his wife who has the cancer. Let me remind you of what he said.
How can you glorify God in your body when it doesn't function right? How can you glorify God? How can he get glory when your body doesn't even work? And the Bible says your body is the temple.
I mean, my friends, to live your life by signs and wonders is just sheer foolishness. One of the clear teachings in the Bible is that we are not to live our life by experience. We are not to walk by sight. We are to walk by faith in what God has said. Miracles can happen today. God is a healer today, but he doesn't need a healer man. He can do it at your hand, and he has. He's done it in the people that I know in my own personal life. Personally, not at the hand of healers, because the gift of healing at the hand of the healer, like Paul in the Bible, started the faith, brought people to Christ. Today we have the completion of God's word, and healings today can bring people to Christ at the hand of the ordinary Christian. God does not need healing healers today. He can use you today to heal just about anybody. The question is he using you? Are you experiencing the gift that can happen for you today at the hand of a healing person, not at the hand of a person who claims to have the gift of healings? If that was the case, the world would be converted to Christ. There's no getting out of that. When Benny Hinn says he came to Sault Ste. Marie, Ontario, in our hospitals and healed people, they asked the nurses after if that was true, and they said, no, none of that was true. I mean, a lot of that is happening on television today. The signs and wonders movement, my friends, is a movement that's based upon feelings. And that's very dangerous. Simply because we have a lot of Roman Catholic people today that believe in God, but they don't believe they're saved. They believe that they're going to be saved by the sacraments of the church. Good works. But they too claim to speak in tongues or speak the gibberish language that we're hearing in society today. My friends, that is very encouraging to them when they get visions like this.
When Our Lady of Fatima appeared at the Portuguese village of Fatima in May of 1917, she could be seen and heard only by three shepherd children. Other observers reported seeing a bright cloud during the visits. The children described seeing a young, beautiful being in the sky. Our Lady of Fatima, who identified herself to the children as the Virgin Mary, told them she would visit again on October 13, 1917, which was to be her last visit, and at which time she said she would perform a miracle, all shall see, so that they may believe. Our Lady said that she would impart three secrets to the children on that day. When the appointed day arrived, upwards of 80,000 people jammed the village. The faithful were drawn by the prophecy of the miracle. A good number of non-believers were in attendance as well, including reporters from major European newspapers. The gathering was not disappointed. The reporters called it a mysterious solar occurrence. The faithful used the term the dancing sun.
When the miracle of the sun occurred, when all these thousands of people had occurred on a very rainy day, pouring rain, all with umbrellas, standing in mud, stood there, waiting for something great to happen, and suddenly, you know, somebody said, look at the sun, and it began to dance. And the frightening thing of it was that as it danced back and forth and beautiful rays began to emanate from it, it began to almost come forward as if it were going to fall. And the people were horrified, just terrible. You read accounts of that, you see pictures of it, and you see these people falling on their knees, asking God for pardon, suddenly seeing themselves as they really were before God. And then it seemed to go back again, and suddenly it seemed to fall back again. It was a phenomenal thing.
The Jesus who came to me in times of deep meditation gave me visions and experiences that were beautiful beyond description. I was convinced that because I was witnessing miracles of healing, because these things are so filled with love, they must be good and from God. And yet one day it occurred to me that I had no objective, absolute truth against which to test my experiences, that my feelings, my emotions, perhaps were open and subject to some form of subtle manipulation which I didn't understand. At that point, I decided to look into the Old and New Testament. I knew that I'd fallen then for the Jesus of the counterfeits.
Trying to develop spirituality based on feelings, ecstasy, or experiences is like building a house on sand. Our relationship with God should be built on a solid foundation of biblical knowledge.
Now, I believe that we are challenged to test the Spirit, that we should read Scripture, that we should study the Bible, and that we should not value experiences higher than the Word of God.
Biblical meditation is thinking deeply on the person and work of God and Christ, concentrating on and knowing His Word.
Most Catholic monasteries and most Protestant Bible schools have introduced one system of meditation or another, and they are based upon the practices of yoga.
As we said in our first report in 2002, the Hinton Ministry relies on the cash that comes in at Pastor Benny's crusades. And since then, according to the documents we obtained and ministry insiders, there is also a great deal of cash going out. According to these receipts in 2003, much of it apparently went to Benny Hinn and his family members. This petty cash chit, $1,300 to Hinn's daughter Jessica, no reason given. And this one, $2,550 to her fiancé for watching Joshua, Pastor Benny's son. According to the expense documents, in just over a month in 2003, more than $23,000 of ministry cash was dispensed to Pastor Benny and his wife, who's also a ministry employee. And we found this record showing $25,000 in cash dispersed to accompany Pastor Benny and for a crusade in Anaheim, California, just 30 miles from his house. In its email, the ministry told us that Hinn's daughter and now son-in-law are both currently ministry employees. It also says it's common practice for ministers, musicians, politicians, and dignitaries to travel with cash, especially overseas, and that every dollar is accounted for. Ole Anthony.
It's not just Pastor Benny. It's all of these big ministries. They start believing that they are special, and all of that ministry money is their piggy bank.
Through his lawyers and spokesmen, we were told Benny Hinn would only speak to Dateline in an unedited format, or if the ministry had editorial control over the interview. This is how Pastor Benny explained it to his followers when he declined to speak to us for our first report.
You may have a question, by the way, on why I did not go on that program. Very simple. The Lord said, don't. I obey. The Lord said, don't. I obey. The Lord said, don't. I obey.
We wanted to ask Pastor Benny about his ministry's finances and about all those miracle healings, especially William's. the little boy from Las Vegas with the incurable eye condition.
Hello, how are you, Pastor Benny? It's nice to meet you.
Last August, he also declined to be interviewed for a story I was working on for the Canadian Broadcasting Corporation. So we approached Pastor Benny after a crusade in Toronto, and we recorded the encounter with a hidden camera.
Why will you not audit and publicly release your finances? And why will you not, if you indeed you do, as you say, verify miracles, why will you not release that medical information? Well, we've talked about this before, and you have not gladly sat.
I asked Pastor Hinn about William.
Do you remember the little boy named William in Las Vegas? Was that a verifiable miracle?
We do it with a pure heart, I can assure you.
Then Pastor Benny explained that he relies on his staffers to tell him about the people that appear on his stage.
When he comes up on a platform,
I'm only able to know what happens because they tell me so.
But isn't that the point, that they don't know, and neither do you?
They're checked as much as possible in the line.
Let's talk on camera.
He wasn't happy when I told him we were already recording our conversation.
We've been on camera.
Right.
Should know that.
But the thing is, I think it's more proper if I can sit with you in a studio, have the questions, answer them honestly, and then let's... But I think to come, you know, at midnight or whatever time it is right now, really is thinking...
Sir, I've been asking you for an interview for 3 years.
Well, I did not...
And I'm still waiting.
Thank you. I'll call you front.
Pastor Benny didn't call.
A serpent is a symbol of Satan. Jesus Christ knew the only way he would stop Satan is by becoming one in nature with him. So what did you say? What blasphemy is this? No, you hear this. He did not take my sin. He became my sin.
Accepted the sin nature of Satan in his own spirit. You don't know what happened at the cross. Why do you think Moses, upon the instruction of God, raised a serpent upon that pole instead of a lamb? They used to bug me. I said, why in the world you got to put that snake up there, the sign of Satan? Why didn't you put a lamb on that pole? The Lord said, because it was the sign of Satan that was hanging on the cross. He said, I accepted in my own spirit spiritual death, and the light was turned off.
For 3 days and three nights, he was in the pits of hell, breaking the powers of darkness to set us free.
The thing that redeemed us was not Jesus being nailed to the cross. His spirit and soul went in to Hades, and he walked in through the door of Hades. Satan was seated on his throne with a sickening grin on his face, his lip twisted in grotesque triumph, and all the imps of hell were dancing a jig. And the word came, we got him now, we've defeated the plan of God. And the devil was sitting there saying, I told you, if you'd follow me, I'd lead you to victory. We got him now. And they wrapped their grimy hands and the chains of hell itself around Jesus, and they consigned him to one of the cells in the Hades section of the underworld. And then Satan and his demon host went on a 3-day drunk. They thought they had him. They had defeated and thwarted the plan of Almighty God, and Jesus sat there, as it were, immobile, not saying a word, not doing anything, except serving our sentence.
My, you know,
Whew. The Holy Ghost is just showing me some stuff. I'm getting dizzy. I'm telling you the truth. It's just heavy right now on me. He's in the underworld now. God is in there. The Holy Ghost is in there. And the Bible says he was begotten. You know what the word begotten means? It means reborn. Do you want another shocker? Have you been begotten? So was he. Don't let anyone deceive you. Jesus was reborn. You say, what are you talking about? He was reborn. He had to be reborn. If he was not reborn, I could not be reborn. Jesus was born again. Jesus Christ destroyed the power of Satan on earth, but destroyed Satan in the underworld, and the Holy Ghost wasn't there. Think about that.
That's when his divinity returned.
Why did Jesus then on the cross say, my God? Because God was not his father anymore. He took upon himself the nature of Satan.
Oh, I'm telling you, Jesus is in the middle of that pit. He's suffering the very base end punishment. He is suffering all that there is to suffer. There is no suffering left apart from him. His emaciated, poured out little wormy spirit is down in the bottom of that thing, and the devil thinks he's got him destroyed. But all of a sudden, God started talking. Then when God starts talking, can't nobody get away from it. I mean, hell itself ain't far enough. It ain't deep enough, and it ain't wide enough to keep the word of God from coming in there.
Well, friends, I just want to say that tongues is not a gift that is in use today, simply because when the purpose of tongues was fulfilled, God no longer needed that gift, very similar to the Sabbath rest. Tithing, tons of other things that were part of God's program at one time. But God's program is being unveiled, is being revealed closer and closer as we get to the end. The items or the ordinances within those programs change. Sabbath rest is a perfect example. Tongues had a purpose, and if you knew the purpose, you would realize that tongues can't be for today. And let me explain. In 1 Corinthians chapter 14, 21, Paul says, wherefore tongues are for a sign, not to them that believe, but to them that believe not. That's verse 22. Verse 21 says, very clear, as it is written. Where? In the Old Testament, Isaiah 28. And if you turn to Isaiah 28, you'll read the same verse Paul is quoting in 1 Corinthians chapter 14, 21. With men of another tongue and of another lip, I will speak to this people, the Jewish people. What is God trying to say to the Jewish people that Paul says, and yet for all that, they would not? He's trying to tell them the glorious gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ, how he died to pay for their sins, but they rejected it. They would not. Now you ask him.
For creating Adam was his desire to reproduce himself. I mean a reproduction of himself. And in the Garden of Eden, he did that. He was not a little like God. He was not almost like God. He was not subordinate to God even. And Adam is as much like God as you could get. Just the same as Jesus, when he came into the earth, he said, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father. He wasn't a lot like God. He's God manifested in the flesh. And I want you to know something. Adam in the Garden of Eden was God manifested in the flesh.
When you say something that disagrees with the word of God, you are literally being controlled by hell.
It was such a spontaneous reaction, and I just stood and looked at the group, and all of a sudden I don't think there's a left leg anointing, but as I'm looking at the group for prayer, my left leg just went flying up, and I said, "More Jesus!" And, oh my God! And when I said that, about five or six of the group just went clonk, and I thought, oh my goodness, and I turned around and kind of with some wild abandon, I just looked at the other group and I said, more Jesus!
Throughout history, so-called faith healers claim to have the power to cure the ailing through divine touch. Today, these pious pretenders are even more dangerous because their televised ministries reach millions of vulnerable viewers. If you've ever wondered how these religious con men are able to talk directly with God, you'll want to pay close attention to the deception of Reverend Peter Popoff. You may already be familiar with Peter Popoff, but in a minute, you'll find out the surprising truth about what he's up to today. For years, Popoff drew thousands of followers to his televised crusades with one simple promise. By speaking to God, he could identify their afflictions and heal them with the power of his touch.
I'm going to be healed today.
Do you believe Peter has the power to heal?
The Lord, through him, yes.
I want to get healed.
Here comes the devil. Oh, hallelujah. Here comes the devil. Back off. In the name of Jesus. Oh, hallelujah. In the name of Jesus. Devil, back. Oh, hallelujah. There it is.
Popov's faithful congregation was so impressed with his divine gift of knowledge that they helped him build his crooked ministry into a multi-million dollar business seen and heard on dozens of television and radio stations nationwide. Now here's a look at Popov's so-called divine abilities in action.
John, is it so?
He appeared to miraculously know their names.
Is that John?
He knew their addresses.
Is it 3784? Woodrow?
And he even knew their afflictions.
God is burning those blood clots out of his veins, out of his arteries now. Let me just come over there. You want God to open up your ears too? Take those hearing aids out. Oh, glory, here it comes in the name of Jesus. Oh, here it is. Oh, when the Lord speaks to me and a true word of knowledge comes forth, I know it. And I know it, and I'll stand behind it. I'll put my life, my reputation on the line because I know God's voice.
Hallelujah!
So how did he do it? This you've got to see. Remember, our so-called reverend claims he's able to hear the voice of God, and now you'll get to hear it too. Listen.
Can you hear me? If you can't, you're in trouble. John and Louise.
John, is it...
The captured audio you're hearing does in fact come from above, but that's where this so-called miracle ends.
3784 Wood Road.
Is it 3784?
Wood Road. The same for his son-in-law, Charles. He's got blood clots and he's had two heart attacks.
God is burning those blood clots out of his veins, out of his arteries now.
What the congregation didn't know is that Popov's wife, Elizabeth, was at a microphone conveniently concealed backstage. Through the use of a radio transmitter and a wireless receiver that fits snugly in his ear, Popov's wife was able to feed him crucial information about his unsuspecting followers.
He has a hearing aid.
Let me just come over there. You want God to open up your ears too? Take those hearing aids out.
Just one.
Oh, glory, here it comes in the name of...
The information was based on prayer cards the audience filled out while they were waiting to get in.
There it is.
Remember, these vulnerable victims truly believe this man can rid them of their suffering, and they collapse because they've seen others do the same. In 1986, Reverend Popoff's dirty little secret was finally exposed, sending his ministry into hiding for several years. So where is he now? You guessed it. Today, years after his scam was revealed to the public, Peter Popoff is still fleecing the masses in the name of the Lord. In addition to his numerous appearances on national television, Popoff continues to pop up on the internet and in households across the country via direct mail.
Ha ha ha.